Wyze had a 3-year-old flaw. VMware warns of Log4Shell exploits, and Apple patches more zero days. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse, and this is ThreatWire for April 5th, 2022. This is your summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. I listen to your story requests, especially from Patreon Alliance members, and this story was requested by several of you, so let's go ahead and talk about Wyze cameras. Wyze cameras have often been a budget choice amongst folks looking for reliable security cameras for home use, and to their credit, Wyze also released this pretty cool hacked firmware that allows you to turn those cameras into webcams. That's neat, but a lot of folks are turning away from Wyze now due to the super delayed disclosure of a vulnerability in their cameras that was around for 3 years that could allow an attacker with remote access to see videos and image files stored on a camera's local SD card memory. Now, a fix is available as of January of 2022, but let's go ahead and break this down. The issues were first discovered by researchers at Bitdefender in March of 2019. They found and reported 3 different issues to Wyze at the time, 2 of which now have CVEs, and all 3 have now been patched. The first of these is CVE 2019-9564, which was fixed in September of 2019, about 6 months after the original disclosure. This was an authentication bypass flaw. Now, Bitdefender discovered that the Wyze cam authenticates remote users via a multi-step process where the client sends a command with a specific ID of 0x2710, the camera generates a random value and encrypts it using an ENR, sends that resulting key to the client, then the client then decrypts the value, sends a response, and the two devices create an authenticated connection. Now, they could skip that set of steps by daisy chaining a stack buffer overflow leading to RCE, which was the second CVE. Now, that second one is CVE 2019-12266, which is that remote execution vulnerability. This one was finally fixed in November of 2020. That's about 21 months after being reported. Bitdefender found that the camera does not check the destination buffer to make sure that it is long enough before it copies the contents to its stack, which results in that RCE. And the third issue was not fixed until January of 2022, nearly 3 years after it was first disclosed. So they already knew about this for 3 years. This one in particular allows for a remote attacker to look at the SD card files via port 80 with no authentication required. This is due to how the Wyze camera interacts with a newly inserted SD card. It creates this symbolic link in a www directory, which has a web server presence, but it has no restricted access. The SD cards contain all of your media files from the camera, so that could be your audio, video, photos, along with the camera's unique ID and AES encryption key. According to Bitdefender, which clarified some of the reporting and gave this quote to The Verge, quote, "The remote attacks require an initial camera ID. It's completely random and non-predictable string that can only be acquired if present on the same network as the device. In other words, if someone connects to your home Wi-Fi, they can get that token and at the later moment, use any of the other working remote exploits to hack your device from their home or wherever else in the world that they are." Now, however you feel about the fact that this last vulnerability would be harder to exploit should an attacker not have some kind of network access already so that they could get that camera ID, the fact that Wyze nor Bitdefender never disclosed this vulnerability over the course of 3 years that this could be exploited is a pretty big concern. Even though Bitdefender is not the manufacturer, usually researchers have some kind of stipulation in their findings that says if the company does not fix or publicly disclose the vulnerability in X amount of time, be it 3 months, 30 days, 6 months, whatever it might be, the researcher will publicly post their findings, and this usually spurs the manufacturer to finally release a patch or update that fixes the problem immediately. That's the vulnerability disclosure and reporting process that we know and are comfortable with. The problem that we see with many smart home devices like Wyze is that home users will set it up once and then never check for updates ever again. And the same could be said for networking switching devices like routers as well. So if there's a vulnerability in the router, your network could get owned. Many manufacturers do not offer auto updates, or if they do, it's opt-in. So you have to do the legwork yourself to get the updates set up. In this case, these updates are now available to patch the vulnerabilities via Wyze's official download portal, but they are only available for Wyze cams V2 and V3, not V1, which reached end of life in 2020 and was discontinued in January of 2022, which ironically is also when they patched this last vulnerability. That means anyone running the V1 Wyze cam, which released in 2017, will remain vulnerable forever. The only way to fix this issue is to buy new cameras entirely if you own a V1 Wyze cam. Bitdefender recommends for anyone who owns V2 and V3 Wyze cams to update the firmware immediately. You can also set up smart home products like cameras on a separated, isolated network. And side note, I'm actually working on posting a video on my own channel about how to do this. An advanced persistent threat group called Deep Panda, aka Kung Fu Kittens, Bronze Firestone, or Shell Crew, out of China, is actively exploiting the log4shell issue in VMware Horizon to deploy backdoors, install rootkits, and steal data. Yeah, remember log4shell over the holidays? Guess what? It ain't over. Deep Panda has been active since 2010, and they are considered one of the more advanced nation-state groups. They have targeted legal firms to steal data, along with technology firms to build CNC infrastructure. Their newest attribution is due to the fact that they are using similar rootkits to previous attacks. Another group, which is called Winty, is also noted due to using similar exploits as well. Researchers at Fortinet's FortiGuard Labs explained that this attack has been observed across multiple countries in a variety of sectors, including financial, academic, cosmetics, and the travel industries. The group uses the log4j RCE flaw to deploy backdoors called Milestone and deploy a rootkit which is called Fire Chili, which uses stolen game development company certificates so it evades detection on those vulnerable VMware Horizon servers. The remote access Trojan is called InfoAdmin, which is based off of the Ghost Rat code, and that has also been seen on these infected servers. Now, Fire Chili is new though, and since it uses these stolen certs, security systems may not detect its installation on a server, and it checks to make sure safe mode is not running as well. It looks for the OS version since it does not work on all machines, and it can tamper with the registry to make sure the registry does not stop malicious processes. It also hides registry keys and TCP network connections, so it's very hard to detect. This is not the only attack seen by researchers as of late on VMware either. Sophos also reported on the log4j vulnerability being used to install crypto miner bots, along with initial access brokers on these VMware Horizon servers. The crypto miners include Z0Miner, Jim, and Mimu. The backdoor includes Sliver, which is a legitimate red teaming tool, but they believe that this is being used as a payload before the crypto miners are actually installed. Another RCE exists in VMware called Spring4Shell, which has been patched. This is tracked as CVE-2022-22965, and it has a severity score of 9.8, and this could allow an attacker to execute arbitrary code or take control of an infected system. This problem exists in the Spring Core Java framework. It's bad because this framework exists in tons of platforms, and a proof of concept was actually leaked on GitHub before a security update was available. In the case of VMware, this affects versions of the Tanzu application service for VMs, the operations manager, and the TKGI, with a full list available via VMware's advisory, which I have linked with this story. Of course, for all of these issues, patching for the main vulnerabilities to combat the exploits is recommended. The problem with log4shell is this problem exists in so many platforms that it may be hard for organizations to find and remediate the issue on all of their different platforms, especially if some of those platforms are third-party or open source. Big shout out to my Hush Puppy Perk Level patrons for sharing their fur baby photos like these ones and for the support as always. And a huge thank you to Robert B and Julian O for joining the Alliance over on patreon.com/threatwire. Let's go ahead and finish out today's episode with my last top story, all about Apple. Now, Apple had some active zero-day flaws that it believes were actually being used in the wild, and patches are now available. There's two vulnerabilities, and these were discovered by an anonymous source and fixed by Apple. The first of these is CVE-2022-22675, which is an out-of-bounds write vulnerability that exists in an audio and video decoding component. Now, this is called the Apple AVD, and it would allow for arbitrary code execution with kernel privileges by an attacker. Now, this was fixed with better bounds checking. The second one was CVE-2022-22674, which is also an out-of-bounds issue, but this one was a read issue in the Intel graphics driver module, and this could allow an attacker to read kernel memory. They improved the input validation to fix this problem as well. Now, patching can be done by simply updating to iOS or iPad OS 15.4.1, Mac OS Monterey 12.3.1, tvOS 15.4.1, and watchOS 8.5.1. Now, this is another great example of why it's so important to check for updates on mobile and home devices, given that these two zero-day flaws were potentially already being actively exploited. And these two aren't the only two issues to be discovered and fixed by Apple in 2022, even though I feel like this year just started. In 2021, they fixed over 10 zero-day flaws across their devices. This year, they've fixed four total so far. The first was in January and was a zero-day memory corruption flaw in many of their products, which could allow an attacker to execute code with raised privileges. Another was fixed in February, and this was a use after free flaw in the WebKit browser engine. And this one was also possibly actively exploited. So as you can see, you should probably be updating as soon as those updates are made available. Hey, do you want to see more tech videos from me? Check out my YouTube channel, youtube.com/Shannon Morse, for everything from tech reviews to security tutorials. And with that, do not forget to like and subscribe to Hack 5. We are almost to 800,000 subscribers. That's very exciting. I'm Shannon Morse, and I'll see you on the internet.